here's a question for you. When you pick up a really old book, or even a really old document, and you start to read it, have you opened up a line of communication with the past, or are you just looking at etchings on a piece of paper that have persisted through time, even if that duration of time stretches well back before your life and might in total be longer than your life? Is it nothing more than what it seems, or is a kind of time tunnel opening up? That's in many ways the theme, or at least the thought experiment, of the story that we're looking at in this episode today. It is Express to Beijing West Railway Station, and my guest here to talk about that story is its author, Mu Ming, aka Gu Zongyun. We had a pretty interesting and very tangent-rich conversation, but of course before I can launch you all into it, get you onto the get you all on board the discussion train, first we're going to get on the news train. So first news item, it's a YouTube video actually. Now, I have not watched this. That's becoming a bit of a theme these days on the show. I don't tend to have read or watched these things. I'm just highlighting them for you to check out. It's a talk that Chen Qiufan did in promotion of the book he jointly did with Kai-Fu Lee, AI 2041. The talk is titled How Chinese Science Fiction Imagines Our Future. It was with Cornell University, and he's speaking to a couple of professors, and a PhD student called Song Han is moderating it. I guess that is not Han Song. Maybe it's Han Song's evil twin. That would be cool. So that's up on YouTube. It's just over an hour and a half long. With videos like that, I prefer not to watch. I prefer to like have it running in a tab, stick on a pair of headphones and listen to it like I would a podcast. But then again, I am a podcaster, so that's not so surprising. Now, the next news item I've got is, it's again, just another interesting YouTube upload. This one's only got 19 views, but it looks like it's quite a gem. It's an just over a 1 hour talk by Gloria S. Tsung, an associate professor of history at Holland College. And she's talking about a very interesting topic. It's a biblical imagery in unlikely places, Christianity and early 20th century Chinese literature. Now, again, I've not listened to this talk, not watched the video, but I'm going to read the blurb or a description, or at least part of it, just so you guys know what's going on here. Here it goes. The first three decades of the 20th century witnessed both a remarkable expansion of missionary endeavors in China and the rise of anti-Christian and anti-imperialist sentiments among Chinese intellectuals. Surprisingly, the authors of this period who championed a new Chinese literature often employ biblical imagery in their works, infusing them with a Christian ethos. And then it goes on to say that Gloria S. Tsung is going to look at that paradoxical relationship, and she's doing it, in a case study of the author Ba Jin's novels. That is awesome. If you guys haven't heard of Ba Jin, he's probably the biggest name author from Chinese lit who was an anarchist, like a left-wing radical anarchist who was in the movement of left-wing writers at this time in history, and kept working in one way or another in the decades that followed, and even after the revolution. Fantastic. Yeah, and if, by the way, if you've not listened to it, I have an episode on a very short piece of Ba Jin's writing, Hong Kong Nights, so do look that up if that interests you as well. Okay, last news item, just got three today. It's an issue of the Chinese Literature and Thought Today journal. This is a spin-off of Chinese Literature Today. Now, I'm trying to remember what university runs that. Don't remember, but in any case, it's a big journal in English language, sort of Chinese lit translation and studies, and this is their spin-off, Chinese Literature and Thought Today. And the new issue, I'm highlighting it because it has a couple of sci-fi related things in it. Chinese sci-fi seems to really dominate my news segments, but whatever. So one of those things is a new translation of a Han Song story. I believe it's from 2003. And it's called SARS Survivors Association. So you probably don't need to think very hard to consider why that could be relevant to things going on today in the world and in China. Another thing that's in there, it's an article called Such Great Sights. It's by Virginia L. Kohn, one of the hardest working, I suppose, or currently working academics studying Chinese lit in the English language. And her essay is called Aestheticizing the Future of Labor in Little Smarty Travels to the Future, which, if you don't know it, is a really important piece of children's literature in the Chinese sci-fi scene from the 80s, when the genre sort of when you could write it, when you were allowed to write it again, basically. Or when windows were opening it for it to be published and read as entertainment. So yeah, that's there. There's some other cool stuff. The academic Chris Song, who's one of his books I've read, has a essay or has writing on poetry in there. And there's a conversation in translation on Liang Hong's China in One Village as well, which has Carlos Rojas, the translator in there as well, and some other big names. Sabina Knight is in there too. Nick Admison. The more I scroll, the more I'm realizing there's lots of names I recognize here, but also names I don't recognize. So if you have academic access, you can download and read everything here. If not, a few of the articles are set up with open access so that anyone can read them. If you have I'm saying this slightly unofficially, if you've got a friend who has academic access, then maybe they could get the PDFs for you. I'm sure the sky won't fall if you were to do that. So these things are up online, but do be aware they've got the kind of standard academic paywall in front of them. Just be aware of that before you get too excited. And if you really want to read that Han Song story, let me know. Maybe I can help you. Okay, that is all for the translated Chinese fiction news. Thank you for listening. I hope it didn't drag on too long, because now I can lead us into, or on board rather, the express to Beijing West Railway Station, and you can hear my conversation with the incredibly smart and incredibly sharp, that's the word I'm going to go for, the incredibly sharp Wu Ming. Right, so on the show I have the sci-fi author Wu Ming. I think it's been a while since I've had an author on, so that's really awesome. Wu Ming, great to have you here. Would you like to tell the listeners a little bit about yourself?
Thank you, Angus, and I'm really glad to be here. So I'm Wu Ming, and Wu Ming is my pen name, and my Chinese name, the legal name, is Tong Yun, Tong Yun Gu. So you can search for both. Tong Yun, the spelling is C-O-N-G-Y-U-N. Wu Ming, you can see where it goes. So I'm a sci-fi author, mostly writing in Chinese. I publish in Chinese primarily, but my work has been translated into multiple languages, English, Italian, Japanese, so on. And currently I'm also a software engineer. As my day job, I'm living in New York City, working for big tech companies. I started writing in 2016. The trigger was like a writing contest online, it's a Chinese one, encouraging new writers to write novelette novellas in different genre. So at that time, I was feeling the calling, but there is something, you know, the motivation was like, I was trying to bridge the gap between what I was working on, which is, you know, some kind of high-tech stuff, with my love or my passion, the long last two passions since my childhood, with my passion to literature. So sci-fi is the perfect combination of those. And then I started. I think this year is my sixth year of writing. I'm still a new writer, but I do learn a lot, and I got a lot from the 6 years past, and I'm sure I'm going to continue doing that.
Awesome. I have a question about how your work maybe feeds into your sci-fi writing. You mentioned you're working for a big tech company. If I think of a modern Chinese sci-fi writer in big tech, the first name that comes to my head is Chen Qiufan. And in, I guess, not all of his stories, but definitely quite a lot of them, you can see where his like day job experience is maybe feeding into the writing he does. Do you feel it's similar for you, or are you not especially focused on that side of science in your sci-fi?
Yeah, definitely. Actually, I work, Chen Qiufan was my co-worker, not at the same time, but we both worked in Google. Yeah, I'm still working in Google. He left a couple of years ago, and we were both working in the Google's advertising kind of department. So yeah, I think I'm more tech driven by him, comparing with him, because I think I'm just a software developer, the actual coder here. And I think he got more involved in business side, but he has really good sense of how the technology goes and the product kind of size. So regarding the question, I think, yeah, definitely. I also have stories, not only one, but a couple of them that has direct relationship with what I'm doing or what I have been done during the, you know, the work in Google. One thing, I think one of those story you can take a look, which is available in English, is the Color the World, which is included in this anthology. This is called Vital, the Future of Healthcare.
Yeah, I'll just describe this one for the listeners. Mu Ming's holding up a beautiful white book with a robot hand holding an apple on the cover.
Yeah. So you can see that this is edited by Ralph Ambrose, editor. I think he's a really good editor, although he's an indie editor, but he's really good. He is living in LA, New York.
Right.
Yeah, the West Coast. And this book was like focusing on the future of healthcare. And my story was, you know, using the experience directly from my day-to-day job, which is some topic covering accessibility. I'm not sure how many of you have heard of this word, but basically there are large portion of our modern UX and UI designs focusing on the issues raised by accessibility. For example, how people with disability can use internet, or how the people with disabilities, certain different levels of disability, can leverage all the techniques that built around us. So of course there are other things in that story, but that one, that particular component, was coming from my working experience. So this is something, you know, I use directly from my working experience, but there are a lot more things that my working experience in tech industry teaches me. I think the most important thing is about the thinking process, or how do we resolve the problem? Because in the tech world, I think one of the most important things you want to keep in mind is like you need to get things done. So there is a very famous quote called "done is better than perfect." So you really, I think it applies to writers, especially for young writers or new writers, because many people, they have great ideas, they just cannot finish one single story. But this is not the case for developers like us, because we use the method called iterative approach, or iterations. So many of my stories were written many times, especially for the longer ones. The novella one, or the one I'm going to tell you is published, or you know, in a more formal format, I will put, okay, this is the first time, second time, third time, things like that. I keep rewriting and rethinking of the stuff over and over and over, and eventually it will become something very different from the beginning, but it does get better. So that is one thing I think is not common for many writers. Although I do know some great writers, they have this kind of habit, but not everyone. I don't think it's a common practice. Once you are done, most people think they are done. That is one thing. And the other thing I think tech industry teaches me is the mindset of learning. So I have been in the tech industry for like 10 years. I started working like 10 years ago. Until today, I'm still learning a lot of things. A lot of things related to work, related to my project, things like that. And I think that is very important to sci-fi writers. Actually, it applies to all kinds of writers, but for sci-fi writers, it's especially important that you can learn, because technologies around us and the environment changed by technology around us is changing every day. And your writing, no matter the content or the format, need to be changed, need to evolve very fast, and you need to absorb those information floating pieces around you from whatever channels available to you very quickly, and you need to have your own way of study, organize and write. So that is the thing. I think that is the most important thing tech industry has taught me. So yeah, there are a lot of other things, but I would just mention this too.
Yeah, I think it's very true about the importance for sci-fi to stay up to date. Like, I would guess it's quite similar in all language media, but certainly like in English language books, English language films, often the writers seem to just be kind of ignoring the existence of smartphones and the internet and how much we use them.
Yeah.
The places where I've seen them most are maybe like thrillers, where they're good for like urgent conversations and secrets hidden on people's apps or whatever. But like a lot of fiction, because they introduce so many complicated problems and things that, you know, ways for characters to communicate instantly, I feel like a lot of writers don't even go there. Not to mention all the crazy psychology of the internet and the way it can drive you mad. But sci-fi is really well poised to get into that. I feel like that is a whole other hour-long conversation.
Yeah.
So I'll keep us moving.
Yeah.
I do have one little additional question about yourself. You said you were a colleague of TrChFic. Mm-hmm. I'm just wondering, in general, since you're now all the way over the other side of the Pacific, closer to the Atlantic now, in New York, what's your experience been as, like, do you still feel you're part of the, like, young sci-fi scene in China? And what's that experience been like, both before and after leaving the country?
Yeah, I think I started my writing in New York, not really in China.
Oh, right.
Yeah,
okay.
Because I was, like, I was like going to grad school in Pennsylvania in 2010, and then I graduate, find a job, and things like that goes on. And I start writing pretty late. I start writing in 2016, which I have been working in Google for like 1 year, and I think I need to write. But you know, so reading can date back to old days, like when I was in China, and I was also, you know, schoolmates with TrChFic. We were both went to Peking University. I did reading like Liu Cixin and some kind of TrChFic and other big authors when I was in China. But the writing started in US. Regarding the new wave of Chinese sci-fi, I'm not sure exactly about what is the range of the wave you are referring to. Is that considering all those you know, from Liu Cixin or Han Song, or just like the real new writers?
Let's say millennial writers.
Okay, for millennial, I think we are pretty closely connected, because, you know, we have internet, we have everything. We were the millennial generation, not a C generation, but we use internet from very early age, right? So I still have I have a lot of connection with all the writers, TrChFic and Xiaojia and the younger ones. I'm not sure if you have heard of them, but for example, Wang Kanyu and Shuang Shimu. Okay, Wang Kanyu is Regina Wang, and I think she is pretty wild. Yeah, so yeah, we know each other personally. We know what they are writing, and we know that we have different styles, but we can communicate very easily because we share the kind of background, and almost all of us have some kind of background in multicultural. So we know what is happening right now. It's not like 100 years ago or 20 years ago, people don't know each other because they are, you know, on the two sides of the ocean. It's not like that. I think that is one thing that not happened. And regarding the actual, you know, kind of recognition and your position in the group of writers, I think I'm a little bit kind of like, you know, not that in the middle of the wave or of the Chinese young writers, because it's not because I was, I'm in New York. Okay, some part of it, the reason maybe I'm in New York, but the reason is like, I feel in our generation, the millennial generation, people are trying to get their stuff done in a more diverse way. And I think it's very good. For me, some people, for example, I should have mentioned it, but some people, they want to, you know, be in the center of the so-called Chinese new writers for sci-fi, and they go to all the meetings, conference, and speak them up, regard themselves as a representative of Chinese young sci-fi writers. But I pay more attention to other things. I want to be the one that connecting to other circles or connecting to other cultures. I can do that, because you know, I live overseas, and I am in the tech industry, and I also have a very great passion about not only sci-fi but traditional literature, or you know, the mainstream one. So I got a lot of recognition and awards in Chinese sci-fi kind of circle. I got Nebula, Chinese Nebula. I got the Galaxy Award. They gave me really great help and recognition. But I am also exploring the opportunities from like a mainstream Chinese literature. And I got some kind of aspiration, help, and recognition there as well. So I'm, instead of being in the center of Chinese sci-fi young writer, I tend to be on the border of that. And I want to enlarge the scope. I want to enlarge the territory, or I want to connect the two or three or whatever dimensions we have here. And I also have working with different creators from different fields. Like I currently am developing something more related to film adaptation of Colors Award. Huh. So yeah, I was working with filmmakers and producers. They are all over the world. So my director was in, he's actually English director, right. But he is living in Japan right now. And my producer, he was in New York, but he now moved to Beijing. And our whole crew was like, you know, all over the world. And I'm also working with some kind of virtual production team, people there in New York. And they are not writers. They are not sci-fi writers, but they are using some sci-fi-like technology to enable storytelling, which really sounds really cool to me. So I'm working with them to get more things done, not in the traditional kind of like writer circle, but in a broader and bigger creator circle. Yeah.
Right. Makes a lot of sense. Mm-hmm. Myself, as a reader and an occasional writer, I really love genre fiction. Mm-hmm. But when I'm when I'm writing, I find that it's not really natural for me to try and write something in a genre. I think mm-hmm. I'm just too stubborn because I don't want to conform to all the things that make the genre. So it's a contradiction. On one hand, I like it when other writers have sort of made it very clear that they're in that circle, or their style ticks those boxes. But if you yourself don't like to be constrained, it's only natural to throw out some lines or to only partly conform. But then the funniest thing is that I think the writers who are often most remembered are the ones who've pushed out, or the ones who are most remembered in the genre but also outside the genre are the ones who have pushed out the territory the most.
Different.
I'd love to talk about that for an hour as well, but let's talk about the story for the episode.
Sure.
So it's Express to Beijing West Railway Station. You mm-hmm. are the author of the story. You probably know it better than anyone else in the world. So could you give us the elevator pitch for the story?
Yeah. Honestly, I am pretty against the idea of elevator pitch of any story. I know it's
horrible business language, right?
Yeah, yes. And because it's really kind of like, for example, for this one, it's really short. Mm. It's 5,000 words, and you can read it like in 10 minutes or 20 minutes, and it's online, free, things like that. Mm. You don't need to pay for it.
Right.
The reason for that is like, I think stories is a way for us to understand complicated information and other things like tweets or your self-expression on social media need to be short, need to be clear, mm. need to be on the to the point. But for story, it might be the only way or the most traditional way, the oldest way for us to understand the complication of the world. And oversimplification of understanding actually caused a lot of problems we are facing right now.
Yeah.
No matter it's like the bipolar kind of thing, you know, those kind of extreme languages we're using, or, you know, some bad influence the social network gave us, actually comes from those kind of oversimplification.
I got to get this in here. I had a meeting, a training actually at work yesterday, a guy who's been with the company, or at least I think with the company more than 5 years and has been doing what he does for, I think, a decade or more. He was schooling us in how to do emails for business, and he actually is dyslexic, but he's worked through that to kind of master this business style of writing an email, and it's the most minimal, stripped down, functional thing it can possibly be. He kept saying, like, you don't need to waste words on trying to be nice, don't ask people how their day is, you don't waste their time. Just write a piece of writing that is designed to keep the ball rolling or to get a response. And on one hand, I thought, okay, that makes a lot of sense, and it's considerate in the sense that it doesn't waste the other person's time, but it also totally throws out all the sorts of social grease on the wheels. It discards the value for the sake of making things shorter. It discards all the more invisible values that you were describing. And it made me glad that I have that writer's, or at least literature degree perspective, that on one hand understands brevity is great, but on the other hand, the extra words sometimes have a purpose that is just harder to measure.
Yeah.
It's worth spending them sometimes.
Yeah, but I think I can give a question rather than like a real kind of summary of this story. I still want to answer the question, but I think it's in a more kind of like intuitive way. So the story, I think, can be concluded or can be introduced to you using the old-fashioned what if. We were usually using in like speculative fiction writing. So the what if question is actually very old school as well. So question might have already been asked by many Greek stories, but I'm asking here again. So the story can be concluded or introduced to you of the what if question is, what if you find a way to change one thing in the past of your life? Do you want to change it? How do you want to change it? So, okay, that is my elevator pitch. So might not be that appealing, but I think it will open the gate for you to the story.
Yeah, it's funny. That relates to like two or three of the questions I've got further down my notes here. Mm-hmm. But yeah, that is like the big dramatic question. Mm-hmm. I'll, just so the readers know what we're going to be talking about, I'll try introducing how the story goes. I won't spoil the ending, but we have it's first person. So someone is narrating their visit. They're getting the train now. It's from Xi'an back to Beijing, right? It's not the other way around. Yeah. So we have a male narrator who's trying to get from Xi'an North Station to Beijing West Station. And I guess for anyone listening who's never been to China, this is an interesting thing that I guess most large Chinese cities will have more than one station, and they are usually named after a compass point. The oldest one will just be called like Beijing Station, but often the biggest ones will be like the South Station or the North Station. I'm not so familiar with Beijing, but is Beijing West Beijing's biggest station?
Yes.
It is, right, okay. And something is a bit strange. This guy's ticket isn't being accepted. And I think, long story short, it transpires that the train he's going to be getting on is a time travel train, and your ticket is some item you have that connects you to your past. And I don't know if you want to spoil it, but he uses a diary in the end to go back, and he realizes he's got an opportunity to change the past and therefore redo a big portion of his life. I think that's more or less it, right?
Yeah.
So I'll take us to our next question, which is, aside from time travel writ large, what's the science driving the story? Because a time travel story, I guess, could be fantasy. So what's the science in the story?
Yeah, so I think there is real science in the story, although it is derived from the science format of describing it. But I think the main thing here, when I was writing the story, the main core of science here is the observer effect in quantum theory. So in summary, I don't want to explain quantum theory here, but in summary... Yeah,
wrong podcast for that.
Yeah, the thing here is like in physics, I'm just reading from the wiki. The observer effect...
You didn't have to say that.
The observer effect is the disturbance of an observed system by the act of observation. Yeah, so it can link to many astonishing quantum theory findings, like the delayed choice quantum erasure and things like that. It's totally sci-fi. I mean, it's more sci-fi than you think about the real quantum theory. But one thing I really want to, you know, build a bridge here is not really about quantum theory to our daily life here. We need a bridge between quantum theory and our daily life. And what I find in between is history. So as I said, I have multi-culture background, not only about, you know, China and the Western or Eastern and Western, but also about, you know, literature and science and, you know, history and all those great humanity studies I have been reading through. So the hidden layer of history of my thought in the between of quantum theory and the personal life story is like, because of the observer effect, history was like, we can imagine that history was shaped by the observer and the recorders of the history as well. So if you think a little bit more, I also mentioned some kind of history stories in this more than story, but you can see like how history played a part between the hard science and the daily life story. So that is one thing I really want to convey. So basically you can imagine there are three layers of the story: the quantum theory, which I don't think anyone will really dig into because of this story, but also the history part, like how our observations actually shapes our history. Or, you know, some more grand history, but for this story, it's more like a personal history and how our personal history actually affect our personal life. So these are the connections here. Yeah, so regarding the question about like the hard science, are you asking that? I'm just reading from notes.
Yeah. Like, okay. I said science, I guess I didn't say hard science. Mentioned quantum theory, but there's more that you want to say about that. Please.
So my way of thinking of using science, especially the so-called hard science in the science fiction, is a little bit different from many other authors or readers. Because I tend to, I'm a science student from my college. I study computer science, information science. And I am also kind of into like not quantum physics, but some kind of physics. So my way of thinking of science is more about a thinking process rather than some very concrete and formatted theories or formulas or ground truth kind of thing. Of course, we need to know that, but the most important thing science taught me was the way of thinking. It's more like a, you know, way of thinking rather than some facts you need to remember or you need to memorize. I think the most important quote I want to read from science, I want to read about science is from this book. This book is called The Art of Doing Science and Engineering.
Right. For listeners, this is a really nice black hardback with like shiny gold lettering, quite small.
Yeah. So this is by Richard Hemming, one of the greatest, I think, ACM fellow. He worked in the Bell Lab with Claude Shannon, our master of information science. So Richard Hemming is also a great master of information science. So
I just realized I didn't make the note. What was the title again?
I will send you. It's called this is actually clear.
The Art of Doing Science and Engineering. Got it.
Okay, yeah. Thank you. Yeah. So I tend to use those masters' viewpoint to describe what is science. And I just want to read this to all your readers or listeners. I would just read it.
Go for it.
Yeah. So Richard Hemming said, "We live in an age of exponential growth in knowledge, and it is increasingly futile to teach only polished theorems and proofs. We must abandon the guided tour through the art gallery of mathematics and instead teach how to create the mathematics we need. In my opinion, there is no long-term practical alternative." So you can see, according to the greatest scientist and an engineer, one of them, it's more like we need to teach something more about the way of problem solving, the way of thinking, rather than teach them some kind of formula or, you know, fundamental truth. You need fundamental truth, but science is more about that. So that is something I want to develop in my story as well. I don't want to tell my story in a way that, okay, because you know this theory and you can understand the story, or if you understand story, you know new theory or something like that. I really want to let people think about it and or give you a pass or passable solution to think about a problem and find your own way to resolve it. Yeah,
that was my feeling as I was, after I finished reading it for the first time, I thought, this isn't really a story that you can solve. It's not a puzzle story with an answer, and I don't think there's any magical theories, but that's fine, because we're doing an interview. We're going to weave all in and out of the story rather than trying to solve it like a math problem or a puzzle. Mm-hmm. So I'll take us on to my first category of questions, all about railways. Listeners of the show who've religiously listened to every episode will have noticed I'm a little bit fixated on railways. Although the railway system here in the UK is not perfect, I have a local train station. I love riding the rail there. And obviously living in China, that was a fantastic chance to go north, south, mostly north and south, but also east and west on the high-speed rail, the Gaotia. That was just phenomenal. So getting back to the story, what led you to pick a railway station as the setting of the story? That's part one of the question. And then part two, why Beijing West Station? Why not another mega station like Shanghai Hongqiao or something?
Yeah, this is an easy one actually, because this one was like a themed writing or like a invited writing for a Chinese science fiction gala during the year of 2018 for Chinese New Year. And the theme here is like you need to use Beijing West Station as a part of your ride. I think I can explain a little bit more about that. I think the theme is really interesting here because Beijing West is like the biggest train station in, I'm not sure if it's only in Beijing, but probably the top three in all over the China, all over the country in China. So it's the portal, especially during the Chinese New Year's Eve, Beijing West is actually the portal sending people home.
Right.
There are a lot
Huijia,
of,
right?
Yeah, Huijia, going back to your country, you know, after a year of hard working in the big city, you need to go back to your country. And for many people, this is a real experience because it's not only about, you know, go from London to Paris. It's not like that. It's more like from your urban life, a modern life, to some kind of rural life or some, you know, even some small village where you don't have toilet. So the connection or the connectivity between Beijing and whatever your hometown is really important because the difference between your starting point and your destination might be very different, no matter it's in the space or regarding, you know, the life of the style of living, or, you know, sometimes it even looks like you're traveling from one world to another.
Yeah.
Because China is so big and the development of each area is very different. So it's not like traveling around Europe and you can see everything very well developed. So that is something really important and interesting here.
Just reminded me of a quote. I'm just going to have to Google it so I can remind myself of the exact wording. Oh, yeah. So you might know this line. It's a William Gibson quote. The future is already here. It's just not very even. It's just not very evenly distributed. I've said on this show enough times to the point of being a cliche that even just a car journey from a Chinese city into the countryside is maybe arguably a kind of time travel.
Yeah.
When I first arrived in China, I was in a small town, quite a wealthy one, called Wukang in Zhejiang. Mm-hmm. And it kind of felt like contemporaneous with my life. I'm from mm-hmm. a small city in Scotland. But then right on the once you were outside of Wukang, you were in the countryside. And that did feel like stepping through a portal. And then when I went back to China 6 months after I went home, I was in Shanghai. And bang, that was the future.
Yeah, that was moving
forward in time.
Yeah, you can feel. Especially if you're in Shanghai and Beijing for the first time of your visiting, and then you'll go to some countryside, smaller towns. I think Zhejiang is actually still very well developed. Mm. But if you'll go to western side of the country, like some small village, I was born in Chengdu. Chengdu okay. is a big city, but to just travel like 100 miles in further into the western side of China, you will find everything is so different. Yeah, so I think that is some very important thing for us to understand modern Chinese life, that things are so different in different area or region of the country. And you cannot really, you know, get conclusion to something if you just visit the big cities. Yeah.
Yeah. And I'm not sure if the New Year journey home has come up on this podcast before. Mm-hmm. And probably most of the people listening, like 9 out of 10 or more people listening, know what a big deal it is. But if anyone listening hasn't been to like a Beijing West or a Hangzhou East or a Shanghai Hongqiao, either when everyone's going home or when everyone is coming back, that's could be the most people I've ever seen in my life. Like standing yeah. on the balcony, looking down on Hangzhou Dong. Oh my God. At the right time of year, it's like nothing else. These aren't just people who are going on a normal journey. They're going to go on probably quite an emotional or at the very least important trip home. It's weird because it in some ways it's kind of similar to going home for Christmas here. It's also so much more hardcore. Yeah. Not that I'm Chinese, not that I've done that, but it doesn't take a genius to see and to understand.
I would say that seeing how people are moving from country to countryside to actually from Beijing to countryside, or you know, experiencing the so-called Chunyun in direct translation will be Spring Festival Transportation. So right. observing that will be a lifetime experience for you. Yeah.
Mm, totally. Yeah. Yeah. I'll take you to my next railway question. Mm-hmm. It's about Han Song. I forget if we mentioned Han Song already. So he's not a millennial. I guess he's like a Gen Xer. I'm not sure.
1916s, yeah.
Right. He's pretty much my favorite Chinese sci-fi writer. I think he seems to be quite popular with certain Western readers. I'm in that group because he's dark and edgy, but also he loves transport and he likes writing about transport and he likes writing about trains specifically. Mm-hmm. And Hao Jingfang has a train New Year story. That one is in English translation, it's in Ken Liu's Broken Stars. Mm-hmm. And it's also got like a sort of a wormhole. I don't think it's time travel per se, but it's got some kind of similar dynamics to your story. So I was just wondering if your railway story, when you were writing it, did you have Han Song or Hao Jingfang's work in mind? And even if you didn't, do you think there are some interesting ways to compare them?
Actually, no. When I was writing this, I was writing from my like own point of view of trains.
I feel like any time an interviewer asks an author, were you thinking of this thing when you wrote the story? Like 99% of the time, they're like, no.
No.
You guess wrong.
Yeah, I think it's really interesting because readers can see the seemingly possibilities of the connection, but actually the connection is somewhere else. But it's really interesting. I think it's the passion or it's the charm of the story itself. Like we are connected by so many things that we didn't notice. For me, this story, the train represents many things. I think the most important thing or the thing I had in mind when I was writing the story is like train is representing the transition of era from, like I said, from Beijing to some small town, small villages, you can see the train is actually connecting from the modern life to the pre-modern life, especially in China in the spring transportation kind of events. And one of the story I do have in mind when was writing the story was Ray Bradbury, the dragon. I'm not sure you guys have read it or not.
I've actually never read any Ray, and maybe one short story that I don't remember, but basically I've never sat down with a Ray Bradbury book. No.
Yeah, it's okay. It's really short, and I will spoil it here. If you're...
Yeah, go for it. Yeah, Ray Bradbury would be mad.
Yeah, so the dragon here is like, it's a really simple story, and I think just a 1,000 words or something like that. So, but it's really something to me, because at the beginning, the story was like two knights, as in the fantasy. They were riding on their horses. They were talking about how to kill the dragon. The dragon was so scary and making big noises and things like that. And you'll feel, okay, this is the Euro-Western fantasy story. But later on, the story developed and the atmosphere was here. And at the end, you'll find the dragon was a train. So that is basically the story. You can see how simple but astonishing it can be, because it actually connecting the two kind of things, the traditional Western story, Western fantasy happening in a middle age kind of environment to the modern stuff, like the steampunk or something. It's actually the train, the passing train actually is representing the dragon as well as, you know, the modern life. So it's really charming, and I really like that. And I think it is also reflected in Ken Liu's Good Hunting. Good Hunting is a kind of like steampunk thing, but there the train also plays a very important part there, especially consider the history background Ken Liu was written, was in the 1930s or 1920s, or the beginning of the 20th century, and the place where the story happens was Hong Kong. So a place where East meet West. So you can see that kind of thing. And train, you know, all those stories are the way of transitioning from old to new, from pre-modern life to modern life. So that is something I was thinking about. But of course, I developed something different here. But to me, the connection was more, you know, in this kind of story rather than how to find Han Song. And another thing I want to mention here is more personal kind of experience. It's like I really like train and use the train as the symbol here, a symbol here for the writing. It's like, I think it's a really good metaphor of connectivity. And I pay a lot of attention to my story, and I use a lot of different metaphors for connectivity doing different story background. And because I think connectivity, the concept and how things go around that, is one of the most important thing internet taught us. Before internet, we don't have the so-called idea of, you know, people can closely connect it like this, and the connection can bring so many great things, and it can bring so many problems. This is a completely new problem or completely new phenomena to the age of, you know, Gen Z and millennial writers. And I don't think many great old writers or great old master authors they are dealing with this kind of thing. This is something we need to deal with. So I explore a lot of things to describe to tell the story about connectivity. What is the good, what is the bad, what is the different format, things like that. Yeah, and I think train is actually, you can see the similarity between train and the concept of connectivity. Yeah.
Cool. So many different thoughts to digest. it's definitely true. Trains can take a lot of different forms in the real world and in our imagination. Like, off the top of my head, I didn't always ride the fast train in China. I rode, there was a couple times I rode the slow train, and it, like, mm-hmm. just the environment, the little mini society mm-hmm. inside those trains is very different from inside the fast trains, for sure. I have a friend back in Scotland who lives in a small town called Brechin, which has a historical railway that's been preserved, and his family actually, I think they've taken over running it, basically. So his mom and dad are like the managers, and in his free time, him and his brother will be driving this steam train. So, like, you know, a real Huoche. It's got fire inside of it, like a like a dragon, like a western a western dragon, anyway.
Yeah.
And he's not like a steampunk guy. I don't think he's a huge history fan. He is an engineer, though. So every so often on his Facebook or his Instagram, I'll be seeing him in his old school train driver's uniform, covered in suit, and he looks like he's from the past. But outside of that context, I don't think he cares much about the past. It's just through the machine that he makes that connection. I was wondering if you ever saw a Chinese film. Its English name is Kylie Blues. Chinese name is Lu Bian Yetan, I think. Yeah. That's got a train that I think it's sort of implied is sort of a time travel train as well. It's done really, really subtly. And I believe that even the Chinese name is a sort of a sci-fi reference. I think it's named after the Russian story.
Yes.
So yeah, that's, I don't know. I didn't really have any comment there, but you might think on first, like if I went up to someone, a friend, and said, yeah, trains are basically about time travel, if you think about it, they'd look at me like I was crazy. But once you dig into it, yeah, it starts to make a lot of sense.
Yeah. I know the movie. I think I have watched it, but probably not in theater. I think I watched it online on some streaming service. Yeah, I do agree that you can see that many directors and creators and writers in China, especially young writers, young creators. So the director, I think he is also born in 1980s, a rising star. Actually, you know, in this group of creators, including me, we were raised up in the age that a train means a lot to us because, you know, when we were at our childhood, in our childhood, China was still kind of like underdeveloped, and the train was the thing that everyone need to ride the train to home, to their hometown for like the spring transportation, or if you need to go to visit your parents or parents, grandparents in other cities.
Yeah, car ownership hadn't taken off, right?
It was no.
Bicycles still.
No, so train was the only thing you can rely on if you want to go to the other city or the other side of the country. So I was like spending 3 days, two nights in a train every spring festival when I was like 5 to 10 years old. Later on, we do have flights, fly back to Chengdu. But when I was a kid, I rode these trains. I took these trains, you know, through the mountains, see all the rural areas, and finally get back to Chengdu from Beijing, where my parents was working on, and my grandparents were still in Chengdu. So that is like a common kind of experience for many, you know, millionaire creators. Yeah.
Right. Crazy. Crazy to think they might have become a millionaire, but they are going to have that same past.
Yeah,
I've actually done a long train from Chengdu. I did a trip, a holiday, flew from Shanghai to, or did I get the train? I think I flew to, maybe I did get the train, I don't remember. But I went to Guangzhou, and then I flew because the trains from Guangzhou to Yunnan, I think, didn't, at least the Gaotia did not exist. I think it has been built or is being built now. But I flew to Dali, and I think from Dali to Lijiang, I did get the train. But then for the next stop, I flew from Lijiang to Chengdu because I didn't fancy the train journey. But for Chengdu back to Shanghai, I thought, you know what? I'll try this. I'll try the 30-hour train journey.
Yeah.
And I think I didn't enjoy it very much. And I think that's because I was on my own. I got the feeling that the people who enjoy the overnight trains or the big long journeys, it's because they did it with their friend or their family.
Sometimes, and sometimes it really depends on, are you stopping anywhere and do you know the history of that part of the country and things like that. So yeah, I think, yeah, we can talk about this for an hour, but
again,
I don't want to.
Let's keep moving.
Yeah, keep moving.
Yeah, like a train, keep moving. Yeah. Don't stop at the station too long. Okay, next set of questions. It's about regret and how regret relates to time. Because it's true, you can't have regret without time. You could have happiness without the past, I suppose, but regret, literally, it doesn't happen unless there is something to regret behind you. So we talked, you said that the basic kind of question in the story is, what if you could go back and change something? And that is, it's the exact same question for a story I recently covered on the show, Atre's Goodbye Doraemon. I don't know if you've read that one.
Actually, I haven't, but I think I know what he was trying to say. I read some spoiler, I think, but okay. Not really the story. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. So the basic idea, you may already know, but I'll say for listeners, basic idea is a millennial guy who's done well in the big city goes back to his hometown, he had done well, but his life has collapsed, but everyone still thinks he did well. He goes back home to his home in the countryside, and it was a poor village when he's a kid, but now it's kind of village society is crumbling. It's even worse. And it turns out he has a way to go back and help the girl who was like his sort of childhood best friend / crush. And he has a way to fix her life and fix his own life, possibly. And it's kind of all about, childhood pain, regrets, going home for New Year, and, the chance to go back and change something. There's a lot of that in all world culture. There's an American film that it's kind of a stupid film, but I think it's quite fun as well. It's called The Butterfly Effect. And it's a very similar deal, I think. A guy discovers he can go back in time, and he immediately tries to use it to fix all the things that went wrong in his childhood. And the drama there is that every time he does something, something else goes wrong. Classic mm-hmm. sci-fi kind of mm-hmm. thing. So I was just wondering, like, what do you think it is that makes so many time travel stories take that approach about trying to fix all the things we regret?
Yeah, I think that is something people, it is probably the most relevant experience you can share using a sci-fi format or using a sci-fi story like that, because it's so emotional and it can be attached to everyone's experience. We all have this kind of moment of regrets or think about, what if I have been done something differently, how it will change our current path, things like that. Yeah, I think the reason for the popularity or the popular kind of acceptance or creation of this kind of story is mainly because of it's so relevant to everyone's life. But for me, even though I was using that in this story as one of the driven force of the story, I don't want to see that there. What I'm trying to do is more than that, because I was using something about document or like a diary or things like that to actually hold your token of changing the past or something like that. So I know, relevance to personal emotion and how the personal emotions inside the reader using a story is very powerful. But that is not the only thing I think the time travel story or sci-fi story can do. In this kind of sci-fi storytelling. So I want to explore something different. So here I will do a little bit of advertising. So I really recommend people who have interest to read the longer story of Mai, which also covers the relationship between time and space, and if things can be changed, what will change, or if you can see the future of your life, of your family's life, or even of the country's life, all the things you loved, what do you want to change? And if you can change, or if you cannot change, how do you accept it or how do you deal with it? So the longer story is the Serpentine Band. It's a historical one, but it is translated into English. And it's a really, really long one. I think it's a novella one. It has 10,000 words, 20,000 words approximately. And it's a little bit complicated. It has a setting in Ming Dynasty. It has covered a lot of different things like Chinese landscape and painting and the history part. But I think it is fundamentally discussing the same thing or similar thing about if we can see the future, or if we can change the past, or if we can alter any part of the history, will we do? Or if we can see, but we cannot change, what we will do, what is the actual feeling we will have. So it's more like a Ted Chiang's classic piece, The Story of Your Life. I think many people know it because of the movie Arrival. So in that story, we were basically talking about a similar topic. Like if you have already seen the future of your tragic, your family tragic, what do you do with that? So I think that is something I think can be explored more in the form of time travel. It can be very relevant to your personal experience, but it can also explore a lot more than, you know, the very traditional question of if you want to fix it or not. What if you cannot fix it, but you know it? I think this is something probably more, interesting and important for us to answer.
Some things in our lives are going to happen.
Yeah.
So some of them are kind of dark and are hard to think about. And there's maybe other things like less personal things like climate change. Mm-hmm. It seems like we're headed for a scary future there. And as an individual, like there is the question of what can I do to make the problem less bad? Like how can I consume less energy? But more realistically, like what am I going to do if, let's say there's a refugee crisis in my country? Like you may as if you're living in the UK, you may as well think about that now in advance because it's probably coming, you know?
Yeah.
Long-term thinking. What was the story or the book you wanted to advertise, just so I've got the name?
I'm actually going to have a Chinese collection published in 1 month.
Like
this is my first Chinese collection, and it will contain some longer pieces which hasn't been translated to English, but very important to me. And I think I did my best in those ones.
We do have quite a lot of Chinese listeners, so you could promote that here and they might well buy it.
Okay. Yeah. So in Chinese, it's Wan Zhuan Huan. The Serpentine Band is the direct translation. And, you know, for Chinese to English translation, it's really very hard to translate novella because it's so long. And especially for this kind of thing, because it's historic and might not be so relevant from the first set to Western readers. But if you are a Chinese reader, I think you should get it pretty easily. But for English readers, I really cherish the opportunity that Neil Clark gave us to actually translate it and publish it in the English magazine, which is something because it might not seem that relevant, but it's interesting and I think it's different from most Chinese translated story, if you have ever paid attention to, what Neil Clark and Ken Liu did. They did a great job, but they pick a portion of Chinese science fiction, and this one is usually not in the kind of the English translations that people will find in those anthologies or collections. Yeah,
totally. Yeah, I did a publishing master's when I started this podcast, and for my dissertation, I looked into like the publishing of Chinese sci-fi, but also the broader context of all translated Chinese lit, at least translated into English.
Mm-hmm.
And to be honest, I wasn't being a very good academic because I went in knowing what I wanted to say, which is, that's why I'm not a scientist. But yeah, I did find that a lot of, if not all, certainly a lot of translated Chinese sci-fi really is outside of a lot of the cliches or the norms. And people like Ken Liu have made things new things possible in English lit and translation. I think probably the big enabler was the explosion of three body into English. Mm-hmm. And perhaps the thanks goes to Barack Obama's PR team for putting it on his reading list. But individuals like Ken and like Neil Clark totally made a difference. Mm-hmm. And I think what you said about the fact it's like a novella, it's 10k words, so it's either a very long short story or a short novella. Yeah, it's, I have been struck reading translated Chinese lit on Clark's World. I go into seeing, oh, it's a web page, so this will be quite a short story. But yeah. The magic of web publishing is the web page can scroll on down for forever.
And the writing is very condensed, and there are a lot of, you know, landscaping stuff, geocrafting stuff, which are not really, you know, familiar with many readers. So there is some kind of effort you probably need to put in. But I do want to bring something totally different. I want to be the one standing on the borders. So I want to push the terrain for translated Chinese story a little bit further to show people something different. Yeah.
Awesome. Okay, I really need to keep us moving. Next question. This could be a short one or a long one. So the story makes use of the many universes theory, I think. So the idea that, let's say I make a choice to go to the shop, maybe in another universe. At that point, the universe splits. We have a universe where Angus goes to the shop, and a universe where Angus stays at home. And then, of course, they're going to keep splitting in all sorts of different directions. And I think the many universes theory says, yeah, these all exist. You just happen to live in one of them. So do you think that's true? And does it affect the way you live your life?
I believe it. I really like the idea. And I really believe in that idea, but not in a scientific way, but more from a, you can say, a religious way. So because, you know, I was working in Google's AR and VR department, although now I'm not working in it, but my husband is still working in Metaverse. So literally he is the one of the scientists that are building the Metaverse. And Metaverse is actually our version, the human version of multi-universe, right? Many people think that Metaverse is just like introducing another virtual world into our world, like what we have been done in so many video games and things like that. But the core idea is not that. It actually enables us to create as many universes as possible, although it's not our physical world, but it's more like a conceptual multiverse. And I really buy in that. Although I know many people don't like that, but I really buy in that. Not only because my husband was working on that, but because I feel like many of the problem we are facing now is our limitation of the imagination of different future, different way of living, different social kind of organization or social kind of, how to say that, the style of living.
And, the norms.
And, yeah, the norms, or even physics laws, or, you know, what is good and what is bad. Mm. So because, you know, the Web2 effort and this, all the social network we are experiencing now is actually, you know, they were created for people to change in different ideas, but they are now more and more centralized, you know, one single tweet or one single hashtag can rule many different minds. Like millions of minds are saying the same thing. This is something connectivity brings us, but it can be something good. We fight climate change or something like that, but it can also cause problems. Like people don't use their brain to think about different future, but they just follow something strongly without thinking.
Yeah, I was saying to a friend recently, some topics on Twitter, they're like a giant magnet or like a black hole. They just suck the focus of so many people and they make it a less diverse space.
Yeah. So I think that is something Web2, that is why Web2 and, you know, the single kind of way of thinking of one word actually need to be change. That is where Web3 and Metaverse, this kind of concept actually comes in, because we feel like even though we developed the internet from a decentralized wish, now it's become centralized because of technology and because of you know, the unawareness of the problem. And we now need some new things to decentralize, to be diversified again, not only by text, but also by our thinking, the way of thinking, and how do we actually be more diverse, not be ruined by some kind of top-down ideology or things like that, to many different topics. So that is why I really have a religious belief in multiverse. And actually my next kind of series of story will be, I will call it, it will be called Many Futures. I don't think one future, one good future can give us all. I don't think that one works. We have been already, you know, gone through so many things that someone promised us a better future, and then we fell. The better future become a hell for many people. Mm. And think only way to resolve it, in my point of view at this time point, is to create as many future as possible. To imagine more than we can actually, you know, have here. I think the truth is about imagination, and the possibilities of living in different worlds to resolve the problem is all about decentralized, diversified, and imagine different futures. We need to release our power to think about different things, different universe. Yeah, no matter it's the real multiverse thing or the smaller human creation we have, the metaverse thing. So that is my kind of thinking here. I will try to develop more stories based on this thought. Hopefully it will be, you know, in a format later on, be, you know, translated or something to be introduced by people. Yeah.
Ooh, there are so many replies I'd like to give about the metaverse and online groups and stuff, because mm-hmm. I find that really interesting. Mm-hmm. But I am going to keep us moving. I'm going to discipline yeah. myself. Yeah. Right. So the next set of questions are about the soul and being a lonely ghost lost in the maze of worlds, is what I've written. I must have been feeling poetic when I wrote that. So you're in the story, you mentioned this a little bit already, that how in the past, or also right now, we're creating a document that mm-hmm. I'm going to put online and hopefully will stay online, get downloaded onto devices, and maybe mm-hmm. stay in existence on the internet, perhaps, I hope, long after I'm dead. But as well as virtual documents, there are all sorts of physical things we create and we leave our marks on. And people mm-hmm. have been doing that since the dawn of history on rocks. It's quite mad when you think about it. And they live long after the person who's created the mark has passed away, and long after their body has probably, you know, become one with the soil again. So I just wanted to ask, do you think that's a kind of time travel? If I pick up I don't know, a Shakespeare play, and I read that, I guess that's a funny example because that's fiction and not non-fiction, mm-hmm. But I will stick with it though. If I pick up that, am I in a way accessing the past in a way that we could maybe call time travel?
Yeah, definitely. I think it's not it's really the thing. I think that it's really the core idea here is like we were using narratives. Narratives can refer to history records, diary or plays, whatever things, story. We were using those things as portal to whatever place we want to be, or dreams. I think dream is the most ancient format of story. Yeah, so mm-hmm. yeah, so that is something you can see in the Kelly Blue as well. The director has a second movie called The Last Night on Earth or something, that it actually changes from, the portal actually changes, or just the way of connectivity between two places actually changed from the train to the dream. So he is using dream as a portal, but the idea is the same. You can see that as well. So that is another religious belief of me. So I had this kind of thing when I was writing stuff. So I really believe in the power of narratives, no matter what format it is. So I really think that is the only way we can actually connect with others, with our history, with our ancestors, with people, you know, living on the other side of the ocean or things like that. story itself is the portal, is the train to get us there. Yeah, right. So yeah, it's not only time travel, it's also time and space travel. It's your, the outer world is your inner world. It is the thing, story or narrative. I tend to use this word more. It is a train here, and totally valid question and great question.
Even a nonfiction needs a narrative for it to hold your attention. And if it doesn't have a sequence, at the very least, if it's just a random scattering of information, it's mm-hmm. going to be, if it doesn't have that, it's probably technically readable, but mm-hmm. not really readable. You're gonna have to really force yourself to mm-hmm. go through it. And probably as a human, what you'll end up doing is taking the pieces and arranging them into a sequence and a narrative, mm-hmm. because that's just what we do. It's about as natural as creating artistic representations of things. It just seems to be as much a part of us as eating, sleeping, and dreaming. It's funny, when you mentioned dreams being the most ancient thing, I think you've got to be right, because we've got a pet hedgehog in this house.
Oh.
And I can see sometimes when she's sleeping, just like a dog, she seems to have dreams, because her leg will twitch. And it's like, well, if a hedgehog can dream, then the stories I've got in my head that are coming from, I guess, partly from dreams, must have evolved from a very ancient mammal, probably from long before the monkeys and the apes.
Yeah. I think my cat dreams too. I can see her. Sometimes she is murmuring, and I think she's just in her dream about hunting or something like that. So I think actually many great movies they are describing this kind of thing. One of the greatest example I can think of is Christopher Nolan. I think Nolan is always trying to convey this idea or express this idea, the inception, the memento, and even the later ones like Dunkirk. But in inception and memento, basically he is using those fancy storytelling techniques to tell us like dreams can be the equivalent of narratives, can be the equivalent of memories, and can be the equivalent of history. So it's actually simple to understand, because in movie production, all the things can be treated as the same. You shoot a scene of dream, and then you cut it, you put it together, and people say, oh, this story happens in dreams, and oh, this story happens in his memory. Technically, they are the same in the movie making process, right? And so if you look into that way, you can see, okay, they are all just narratives, or the word I will use here is dimensions. There are different dimensions of narratives, and if you don't really need to think about the dimension, is a dream or a memory or history records or something like that. They're just the different dimensions.
Yeah, and almost all of his films are tied up with time in some way or other.
Yeah.
Which, time, dreams, moving through the world. And this is a real reach, but what you were saying about the metaverse giving you spaces to make other ideas possible, the big con the main characters are pulling off in Inception is all about taking their victim. So the main characters are basically the bad guys in that film, aren't they? They're the criminals. Yeah. They're taking Cillian Murphy into a virtual space inside his own head, because that's the only place where they can push him to reach a certain conclusion that he couldn't have reached in the real world. He needed to go into a what you can call it, a dream or a created imaginary space. Mm-hmm. We're getting lost again. So let's get back on the train. Okay. So a few times I didn't start this show in the pandemic, but when I started this show, I had come back to my real life from quite an easy life teaching English in China to trying to start my career. I was not always very happy, and just when I could have been really making a move, the lockdown happened. And although I kind of enjoyed lockdown because it was so interesting, for a literary mind, it was really a really intense experience. But it was also, you know, I guess for years, a lot of people of a liberal or lefty mindset in the West felt that everything was going wrong. We had Brexit here in the UK. And with the election of Donald Trump, you heard things in pop culture about maybe we're in the wrong universe. We've gone down the wrong track. And then COVID-19, if you were stuck on that idea and you hadn't become mentally normal again, then COVID just seemed to make that more real. And this has come up on the show again and again. So I wanted to ask you, do you ever feel like you've left the main thread of the universe you're supposed to be on and that you might be going down a different one?
I think for me, it's not that surprising to me. Like I were like falling down from the idol world, if that is the word we were choosing here, because you know, I grew up in I was raised up in China, and I read histories. Both of my parents are like Asian Chinese literature, and there are so many bad things happened from 3,000 years ago. So I know that there are tragedies, there are bad things, there are like things people cannot really accept when they were at their age, or in that era, it happens. I don't think the pandemic is the only bad thing happening in our modern life. We do have like the two world wars. We do have a lot of different tragics happening. Even people, you know, in China, people are still suffering, you know, in many places. And although pandemic is one thing that gave us great kind of impact in a bad way, there are a lot of other things that I cannot even imagine I can suffer or I can survive. They're still happening today. So I don't think that is something that, you know, crashed me or, you know, distract me because of the pandemic, the nature of pandemic. What I'm trying to do, and probably that is one reason for my writing as well, is to find some explanation or find some solutions, possible solutions, at least from a person's perspective, to see why it is happening and how do we deal with it. Although I know these are so big questions and there are not so called like a right answer or something, but at least writing those kind of stuff helped me thinking of it or find my own way through it. Like, how do we actually overcome those kind of trauma? How do we actually overcome those kind of loss, those sorrow in our life? So I do have some kind of writing, recent writing, haven't been translated to English, but I was trying to describe or express the feelings we have had during the pandemic, during all those terrible things. And I think I found the answer. I think the answer to me, especially at least for my story, for my concluded story and my upcoming Chinese collection, I think the answer is actually narrative. It's that we need to tell. We need to tell the story not in a very realistic way, but with some kind of hope, with some kind of new possibilities, with some kind of multiverse-like attitude. Like, we need to use the imagination to create the future for us. So that is my answer, at least for now, to solve the problem. I don't think the idol world exists anywhere in the universe. I don't think that there is a perfect universe in the multi-universe. That every universe has its own problem. And the way for us is to create as many universes for us to resolve it. Probably is to create as many universes as possible and examine it, live in it, and change it by creating another universe. So I know this sounds crazy, but that is what I'm thinking right now.
It's the answer we'd expect from a sci-fi writer. One possible answer we should expect from a sci-fi writer. I agree that, once you take it the full view of history and the idea that the troubles we've had just now are some huge break in the continuity of history is silly. I guess I thought I understood the idea that everything always gets better over time in history. I thought I was too smart for that idea, and that I wasn't a sucker for it. But looking back now, I can see, yeah, I was kind of a sucker for this idea that if society seems to go backwards, the world must have broken. But no, society has gone backwards and forwards through,
yeah,
you know, through Chinese history, through European history. There have been leaps forward and there have been leaps backward. I think now that I'm in a job and stuff and I'm more attached to the real world, I feel like I have something I can do, whether in this podcast or writing or in my workplace, to like just do something, because it's all you can do.
Boring,
not very sci-fi answer, but
no, I think it's actually the same answer. I mean, you are also doing the narrative thing. We are just in different format. I really like talk to people who, you know, who host a podcast or, you know, just to be a social network influencer, things like that. I know looks like it's different from a writer, like a story writer, but actually we are talking about stories. Stories not need to be a novella or something that in that formal. We talk, we change experience, we tell our personal feelings just in different format. And I think that is really, really very, very important, especially in this era of information, in the era of, you know, mass media and communication, because I feel like you can reach to people as deep as you can. You know, I mean, sometimes I even feel like Shakespeare or other one, if they were today, they probably will be a podcaster. They will be the top one podcaster as well. So things are changing. So don't. I think it's actually, one thing I really agree with you is like, no matter we are doing like a podcast or writing a story or writing directing a film, I think the work we've done, no matter just cutting, editing, inviting guests, or just to stay in your own room, write a novella or novel, it's actually make you feel better. I think it makes me feel very stable. And in the changing world, in all those kind of crazy news going on, I need to get something to make myself stable. I need to gain the self-efficacy that, you know, I can control. I still can control myself, even if I cannot control everything else. I still need a way to control myself and express my feelings truly and absorb all those information and, you know, convert them into something good, at least in my point of view. I can still achieve it by doing the creative job. So that is why I try to use the word creators rather than writers, because I think writers are so limited in this world. Creators can be everyone, can be podcaster, can be director, illustrator, and you know, social media influencer, things like that. So I feel like we are doing the same thing, just in different formats.
Yeah, no, that is an interesting thought. Like if someone like Shakespeare, or to give a Chinese example, Lu Xun, was trying to were alive today, like would they be using the same medium?
Yeah.
Would they be online?
Yeah.
I'm gonna make a theory. I think Shakespeare, he was too good at drama not to work in that medium, but he's trying to reach a big audience.
Yeah.
I guess theater was the most popular thing at his time. Yeah. I think today he'd be writing Netflix series.
Yeah, definitely. And I think Lu Xun will definitely be a great Twitter master, because he was
angry tweets.
Yeah.
Yeah. I was going to say he could do blogs, but blogs are kind of, it might have a Substack maybe.
Yeah.
Yeah. Or a YouTube channel where he rants.
Yeah, definitely.
I can take we're definitely getting silly, so I'll take us on to the silly miscellaneous questions. The next one is if you'd like to suggest a Chinese word of the day. Do you have one ready?
I would just say the one I have repeated for many times. I would just say xiangxiangli. I'm not sure.
Xiangxiangli, I don't know that one.
It's just a translation, the plain translation of imagination. Yeah.
Oh, right.
Yeah. So, it's a word. It's a common word, and it's used by you. There's nothing fancy around that. It's just the translation of imagination. But I think it's really important, at least to me, and important to all the things we were talking today. So it is so important. So I even put it on my personal website. So if you check my personal website, there is actually a quote by English poet, the William Blake. So if you check my, let me send you my, so this is my personal website. If you look into that, the front page.
Metimin.me, that is such, I've seen that one before.
Great URL. Oh, thank you. Yeah, so you can see the other thing I put, the most important thing I put on my personal website front page is this quote by William Blake. He says, the imagination is not a state. It is the human extent itself.
William Blake is a cool guy.
Yeah. So I think when he was writing this, he was like, 20s or but it's really 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 important. It's really very important, and I think I got this quote by another British Irish writer, the great Yeats. Yeah, so Yeats is actually talking about this when he talked about the folklores in Irish, and I think these are some kind of my inspirations, because I feel like even though they are in the era of, 90 to 20 or even older time, like the pre-modern life, they sensed how important imagination can be even today. It's still applied. And I don't think people today know what is really, know how important it is as deep as this great artist, this great writers, they know. And we have already talked about so many about imagination, why it is so important in the multi-universe or in the metaverse or in the age of information. At that time, like 200 years ago, William Blake, they told us, and yes, they told us that just by their imagination, they can imagine that imagination is so important today, and it is the human itself. Actually, my Chinese collection, the Wan Zhuanhuan, actually uses as a main theme for all the stories. I have 8 stories in the book. I use this single quote as the main idea I was building the whole universe in that book. I don't treat it as a poem or like a metaphor or something. I build a word around this. I at the end of the last story of the in the collection, I made this literally mean that imagination equals human. I made the equation stand. So so that is why I put it here. It's so important. And imagination here actually refers to other things we covered today: history, narrative, story, memory, personal history, or the grand history. So actually, if you think further, if you think about what is human, it can lead us there very naturally, because nowadays we are more or less changed by our experience about thinking what is human. I mean, like 100 years ago, we know that human need to be, you need to have a body, right? You need to be some monkey-like animals, and you need to make tools, things like that. But later on, nowadays, as we are living in the age of information, living in the age of social media, I think it's not really hard for people to accept or for people to think about what is the real human being actually means. Maybe our social media expressions are more essential as a human comparing to our body.
And yeah, we are, if I type something into the internet, I'm choosing consciously to leave a mark that I think is my expression of myself, whereas what I do in my daily life is a lot more random and less perfect.
So this is an old mind and body problem we were thinking through the ancient Greek time. And now I think it is the time for us to rethink it because of the power of internet or technology or things like that. I think people will revisit this kind of story, like what is human, because of the move of the technology. And I think in my stories, in my sci-fi kind of imagination, we will reach an end of the long-lasting thinking journey that humans, what is human? So I will just do the spoiler here because I think it was saying that I think at the end of the story, we will feel like we body doesn't define us or identity or whatever physical limitations. These things doesn't define us, nor those tags like your identity, your kind of, you know, which country you are living in and what's your background and things like that, or what's your, you know, kind of, you know, ethnic group you're belonging to. Those kind of things doesn't define you as a human. The only thing defines you here is your mind, but the mind can be more specific. It's the way you are processing the information and related attached to all your memories, all your experience, but not in a physical form, but in more like a virtual form. You can imagine yourself as a big neural network with storage. So that is, you know, I am an engineer. I'm very open to this kind of idea. And this actually, this can actually be the equivalent of a story itself. So story is also a way to organize information, to organize all those, you know, sub-components, dreams, memories, personal experience, and re-express it in a self-contained way. So I want to draw the equation of dreams or narratives or stories equals human, which also respond to William Blake's quote 200 years ago, that imagination is not a state of human. It's the human exchange itself. So that is why I choose this word imagination here. So
perfect.
Yeah. Hopefully it doesn't sound too crazy for you, but you know, give you some kind of different thoughts. Yeah.
It does. I have a quick question. The background image that you've got for metamin.me, is that a bridge at Westlake?
Oh, you are so good at it.
I used to go to Hangzhou every weekend, I've been across that bridge a few times.
I took it by myself because I don't want to run into, you know, copyright issues. So I just picked something back to myself.
Aside from the fact that it's a place I have memories at, I ask because if I'm remembering my history books correctly, that's a man-made lake, right? That's a product of human engineering from...
Yeah.
A long, long time ago.
Yeah.
So it goes to show that the things our imaginations can create can take all sorts of forms, including a lake. And even if a man-made lake is not a story, I know for a fact that from reading Chinese lit in translation, a lot of stories have been affected by West Lake and are set around it.
Yes.
And it has, you know, it has a certain kind of romantic, peaceful, beautiful mood.
Yeah.
If you go there in real life, I think you'll feel it, even if the weather is bad. And if the weather is good, it's an amazing place in all weather. And in stories, some of that's there as well.
We
could talk about West Lake for an hour.
Sure, definitely. West Lake is one of my favorite places as well. Mm. We can talk it for an hour, but we can keep moving.
It actually stopped me. So I was commuting by bus usually. It was more convenient than the Gaotia, ironically.
But
I was going into bus from Wukang to Hangzhou almost every weekend, but West Lake stopped me exploring Hangzhou because I just wanted to go to West Lake every weekend.
Hangzhou, the city of Hangzhou is actually building around West Lake. If you know that, and there are a lot of stories happening here, and I think historically there are like two bridges. One is called Su Di, the Su Bridge, and the other, or Su Dam. Depends on what your thoughts are. And the one is called Baidi. So those are actually the two bridges or two dams are related to two of the famous writers or poets in Chinese history. One is Su Yi, Su Dongpo, Su Shi, and the other is Bai Juyi. So they were serving as Hangzhou's governor in their age. So they both like White Lake so much, and they built like two dams or bridges for the citizens to, you know, go from one place to another. And yeah, there are a lot of things we can talk about. And there are also more than great architecture efforts in or architects. One of the most innovative Chinese architect, he built his stuff around Suzhou, around White Lake. So we can talk for 4 hours for sure. Yeah.
Easily. Yeah. That'll take us to our next question. It's a piece of music you'd pair the story with. Do you have one?
Actually, I don't have one specific song here. I will just recommend, I will give you the link here. I will recommend the original soundtrack of a Chinese movie. The Chinese movie is by Wang Kawei. The Grandmaster. So it's a movie about action. It's about kung fu, but the movie is really beautiful, and I think it actually has the best train fight since I have ever watched. Yeah, and the setting is about 1920 and to 1930s. You know, during the World War II. Actually, 1930s to 1940s during the World War II. So you can see that it's also a conjunction of different time, like we have discussed, like some pre-modern to modern, and the film beautifully shot, and the music are composed very well, and the train fight is a thing you must see. And I think the train actually resembles what we've talked about, because the fight is all just next to the train. And at the time, the tradition Chinese Kung Fu has, you know, need to give the place to the guns, to the modern world. So it's all related to what we were talking about. The history need to make a move. And there's train, the Western stuff comes in, and the invade from Japanese comes in. So all those stuff are beautifully mingled in that story. And I recommend watch the movie, but I mean, to the story, to my story, to this simple one, you can see, I mean, the relationship might not be that clear, but I think if you have been listening to our podcast for these 2 hours, you will feel why I choose this. There are connections here.
Perfect. Yeah. I'll have popped a little snippet of the soundtrack into the episode, so hopefully the listeners got it. My one is pretty different. It's, although you could say it's a bit cinematic, it's a track by a musical duo called The Black Queen, and the song's called The End Where We Start. Has a sort of a time loop sort of thing just built into the name, and it's reflected in the lyrics. I think it's kind of reflected in the mood of the song. It's a very dreamy song. It's very peaceful. It's a little bit melancholy, but it's not it's not high energy. It's not a fight scene kind of song. And I think some of that dreamy, sad feeling for me was in your story, Express to Beijing West Station. And mm-hmm. we haven't really said why a time loop might be relevant to the story, but the idea that the end is where you start, I think, is powerful, it's resonant, and it must have felt relevant to the story for me, because just after reading it, that's the song I picked. So mm-hmm.
yeah, I listened to it. It's very different, but I really like it. yeah,
I like that group a lot, Black Queen. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Okay, then the next question, this is one I put on the show's Patreon account. So listeners, you're just going to hear, because I'll have sped it up and cut it out. If you want to hear what Muming's answer was to this question, go sign up for the Patreon. So my question for you is, I'm going to read this precisely. Do you have thoughts on the aesthetic experience of riding by rail? And do you have any favorite railway stations in China or in the world at large? I could go on and on about that, but I think I'll close off the bonus question and take us to our final questions. So I realize I haven't adapted this question. I've written, if our listeners want more like this book, where would you direct them? Well, it's not a book, it's a short story. And it's your short story. So I guess the obvious answer is we could direct the listeners to more of your writing. So I'll let you do your advert. Also, though, what other stories or books that by other writers do you think you'd point listeners to?
Yeah, definitely check out my other stories. Although they might look different than this one. But, you know, as we have talked, I think I hold some fundamental kind of belief or some fundamental view of the point of the world. So you can see the hidden connections between all my stories. So I will put my personal website here, and also I will give the links of my stories with English translation as well as like other languages like Italian translation. I do have an anthology here in Italian. So this is by an Italian publisher, which I'm really... Oh. Grateful.
Is that, by any chance, is that Francesco Verso?
Yeah, it's Francesco Verso. So, yeah, so he made really great effort in translating Chinese story into Italian directly. So,
yeah, he's like Italian Neil Clark, basically.
Yeah. And I'm really grateful that I have him publishing my first book, not in English, not in Chinese, but in Italian. And I think Italian readers, they like it pretty well. So I was in a book fair in Turin, the Italian city, this May, actually. So I met a lot of readers here. So if you happen to know Italian, you can check this out directly.
You can read Colora il Mundo, is it?
Yeah. Colora il Mundo. Nice. Yeah, color the world. Yeah. And for English, currently, I have four of them translated, and more incoming. And as I said, there are also like adaptation programs which can be shared more easily rather than like translation. And also I plan to do more in writing as well, like short story series, as well as novels. And I will try to get them as much translated as possible, because. You know, I really want to reach as many readers as possible. Regarding the story like this, it's really hard for me to say because I feel like although I got influenced by many readers, but many writers, but for reading, I think it's really like a personal taste kind of thing. And what I usually find is like what I feel, you know, the similarity between stories and stories, or the inspiration I got from one story to another, it's not the same with everyone else. Looks like I got a very strange kind of perception of the story, and no one holds the same idea as me. But there is one story I think I'm not sure if it has a kind of like English translation, but it is by Lu Xun. I think the idea here is somehow similar. Let me see if it has a English translation. Probably not. But if you are reading Chinese, you can find it. The Chinese name is called xianwei. English translation is the fiber. Fiber by Liu Cixin. It's a very short story, but it's really well written. I think he used fiber as the same kind of or similar kind of concept of you know, trains connected, and there is a conjunction of the fibers. So although the story is pretty different, but I think the core concept of the world building here is the same. And if you do like that, you can check that out. And for historical one, because there is like a historical element inside this story, I do recommend a lot of we called historical sci-fi in Chinese. Mm. I'm not sure how many of them has been translated.
There is one in a Ken Liu book, The Snows of Jin Yang.
Yeah. That's by Zhang Ran. And there are a lot of great pieces in that genre, but probably not really translated too well. But I think we should pay more attention to that genre, because in Chinese literature, history is such an important thing, and many great authors build great stories on that. And I'm trying to do more things on that as well, because I think in English world, the thing of story retold or revisiting like the ancient Greek mythology or retelling the story of Shakespeare or those classics is also a very big thing, not only in sci-fi, but also in the mainstream literature. Mm. I think one of my favorite authors in English world is Margaret Atwood. And she has a lot of stuff written in this format. And even, you know, in pop culture, we have George Martin. I think in the Game of Thrones series or, you know, the Song of Ice and Fire series, you can find a lot of historical elements. And another favorite author of mine is the British one who wrote the Ken Follett, the one who wrote the Pillar of the, what is English name?
Pillars of the Earth?
Yeah, Pillar of the Earth.
Yeah. I think my uncle once gave me one of those books when I was a teenager, but it was like book three. So I picked it up and I was like, what? I didn't know what was going on because he didn't give me the first one.
Yeah. There is actually a English drama on that. And I think I watched it when I was in college. Hmm. I really like it because that is one of the first like the historical contemporary novel I was watching, a novel adapted drama I was watching. I really like it. It's only like three or six or episodes, but it's really, really well, very well crafted. So I think in English world, the effort to retold classics in a modern way or retold classics combine the classics into some modern literature is a really big thing. And in Chinese literature, we have similar things, although it's not as popular as that, because I think people are still trying to get used to this kind of new format to do the writing. But it's a rising kind of thing. And I would imagine there are a lot of stuff, great stuff coming out. And because I learned a lot from what George Martin did, what Ken Follett did, I would imagine that the other great authors will have great impact in, you know, the multicultural kind of communication as well. And I do want to see Western readers' reaction to the Chinese Asian story or Chinese classic retold kind of projects. Yeah,
you reminded me there of something I meant to say earlier and forgot when you're talking about travel being part of the literary history of dynastic China.
Mm-hmm.
Journey to the West, that's like one of the four classics. Yeah. And that's a slow journey.
Yeah.
Not going to Chengdu, but close enough.
I like that as well. And there are a lot of, you know, different variations and retold format of that story.
Yeah, I did see one of the more recent films, film adaptations, and yeah, I definitely felt, okay, it's the same basic story, but the aesthetics are definitely bringing in, like, modern designs, modern styles. So it's not changing the story, but yeah, the modern world is leaving its mark for sure.
Yeah. And I think this journey or travel or grand travel or journey thing is it's one of the, not only for Chinese literature, but also for the greatest, those classics, especially in fantasy.
Quest,
and also Lord of the Rings. Mm. That is one of my favorite as well. All the stuff is about a journey. Mm-hmm. A journey. I watched the movie about Tolkien, his biography movie.
What is that called? Yeah. I think it's just, is it just called Tolkien, maybe?
Yeah, I think it's called Tolkien. But I think something the movie doesn't really catch up. It's like, I think the main theme of that movie is a fellowship. Mm. The movie was actually, based on his experience in the World War One. But actually, I think if you look closely into the works, or especially in Lord of the Rings series, you will find journey is actually probably the most important theme comparing to fellowship. And a lot of great authors hold the same idea as well. For example, Ursula Le Guin, which is also my greatest influencer, author, the greatest author to me as an influencer. She really put it in the way like, steering your story craft. So this is one of her books, telling us how to write story. She really states that a good story should take you to a journey like a ship, and take you to different world, and it send you back. You are still at your own place when you close the book or when you finish the story, but you are a little bit different inside because you are experiencing a journey. You have done that travel, and that travel make you a little bit different. So I think that is the best illustration or best kind of expression of what a story is. Very simple, but very concise.
Absolutely.
Kind of, yeah.
It's definitely true in Lord of the Rings. They never stop moving. It's a great advert for hiking and horse riding.
Yeah.
Okay, last question. What are you reading just now?
Oh yeah, this is easy. Because what I'm reading right now is not a really, story. It's more like a self-help book. It's called Creative Confidence, Unleashing the Creative Potential within us all. So this is more, it's not a, the creative thing here refers more to designs. So this book was by a designer, a legendary designer in Silicon Valley. I think I forgot his name. Sorry about that. But the author is basically their form actually designed the first version of mouse, of the Apple mouse. So you can see how legendary the book is. And the author is also the founder of the design school in Stanford. So basically all those kind of industry design, interaction design and the human-centric design, those ideas are like invented by those by the authors. So you can see, and I think he also has a TED Talk, very, very, very short one, introducing this kind of effort. And the main idea of this book is tell people that you can be as creative as you wish to be. The creative, no matter it's writing or just, develop some kind of new ways for you to solve the problem in your life, this is not magic. This is not some mysterious thing that can only be mastered or can only be owned by writers. It can be done, or it can be owned by anyone. This is a thinking process. It's a thing very natural to every human being. I haven't really finished reading it, but I have already got many good examples here. One thing here I want to mention to you is like the author said, there is no, he also got this from one of his friends, and that friend was a translator translating from Tibetan to English. Wow. Yeah, so yeah, we are also talking about translation here. And from Tibetan, you know, there is no corresponding word of the concept of creativity. So there is no word in Tibetan describe those kind of thing. And do you know, or can you make a guess, what is the closest thing or the closest word in Tibetan describing the idea of creativity?
Is it dreaming?
No. No.
Writing?
No.
Building?
Closer, but still no.
I'm going to have to stop guessing.
Yeah, or actually, the word here is actually nature or natural.
Oh.
Yeah, so what that, yeah, yeah, so this is very interesting because from this point of view, the author also make it very explicitly. It says that creativity or the ability to be creative is not something we learned or we need to a lot of training or something. It's something every child can do in their childhood. We are born with that. So it's very natural once you get the idea. You see everyone, you know, in our when we was a kid, everyone can draw, everyone tell stories, although sometimes it makes sense. But everyone are enjoying playing, you know, listen to stories, bedtime stories, play with their little toys, making funny stuff. These are our gift. These are our talents. Everyone has that. But later on, when we become older, when we went to school, when we got trained by the social pressures or things like that, we are suppressing our creativity. We obey more rules, we play by the rules, we're thought, okay, we're not gonna do this. We just do our daily job, get a paycheck and things like that. So we are not getting our creative, we are lost in our creativity.
Mm.
So that is the reason why they think, the greatest designer think, it's not hard for you. We just unleash what's inside of us that got suppressed. So that is why they say, even after like 20 or 30 years of modern life, as a, you know, as a modern person in the modern society, you can still gain your creativity pretty easily just by some kind of training or some kind of, you know, mind shifting process. And I think to be a creator is the way for us to unleash the burden or to remove the thing that the society or all the around the environment are putting on us and become our, to find our inner child, to find our creativity that was born with us. Mm. And I verified it. I verified it by transferring myself from a boring software engineer to a writer. I transform myself completely by doing this. I find my own child inside myself during the past 5 years. So I think everyone can So I really recommend this book.
That is great, yeah. Because I'm the opposite. I grew up thinking, oh, I'm going to be a famous author, blah, 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 blah. But of course, reality bites. Reality comes home. And I've had to teach myself to also be the more boring guy. But yeah, I think what you were saying there, I could link it back to trains, because one thing that makes us different from trains is a train has the powerful engine, but it needs a driver to control it to go anywhere.
Mm-hmm.
We've got these powerful engines. Like I use my writing powers to earn a living every day, and my digital media abilities that I learned, Jesus, from when I was about 4. I think I was first put in front of the internet like age 4 or 5, something crazy like that. I have all those powers and I use them to help another company work, but there's no, those, you know, when my boss stops being my driver and I'm my own free time, that powerful engine for making digital content or for writing a story is still here and he's mine. I'm also the driver, and it's easy to forget that. If there was more hours in the day, it might be a little easy to remember that, but there's enough hours in the day to get stuff like this podcast and your stories out there into the world.
Yeah. I think, yeah, it doesn't really matter if you're like writing a traditional kind of novel or like whatever thing. Podcasts can be very creative as well. I think our way of doing it is pretty creative.
Hope so.
This thing can be not that, you know, traditional. It's already a thing that, you know, you can show whatever format. If you read the book, you will find many, many creative examples, not only limited to the traditional kind of art professions.
I think I meant to say earlier was you were saying how, oh yeah, a podcast can be a bit like a creative work. I think on one hand, this is definitely second order because I'm talking about other stories. But a thing I've noticed in other people's shows is themes often emerge over time. You can see that a podcast about, I don't know, let me think, one about movies, the perspectives of the people who host it and their conversations will start to produce an overarching theme that reoccurs. And when a writer writes for long enough, the same thing happens. Like, maybe without even intending it, a lot of your stories start revealing something about, I don't know, people who were friends in school together, and you didn't set out to do it, but it becomes a theme. And I think second order stuff like book reviews or podcasts can do that too. If you stick at it long enough, just like a work of art, bigger ideas just magically emerge without you even forcing it. And I hope that's happening with mine. I think it's changing over time. As I've become a bit happier, it's become less existential and more hopeful, I think.
I think it happens to me. Like, when I would start writing, I write so many different things. You can tell it from my early writing. I tend to use different format, different style of storytelling. But later on, I think when I was putting my Chinese collection, I found like something was always there. It takes me like 5 to 6 years to notice that. And I feel sometimes I did get like an aha moment finding all those things are connected. Sometimes, you know, in a way of a tree, sometimes in a way of a web or a net. I feel all these pieces are coming together, combining or connecting in a very unique way. And that is why, I think that is why also it inspires me to think about what a human is. At least as a creator, I am a net or I am the web. Those connected things, those connections, those kind of, you know, knots, conjunctions actually makes me, at least my writer personality.
Yeah, you have your meta Ming and the meta online persona and they all click together.
Yeah.
Okay, we could keep going on about this forever, but I will say goodbye now and thank you so much for coming on the show.
Thank you for having me here, and glad to hear that, glad to send my words to the podcasters and to the podcast listeners, and feel free to find me through emails or whatever thing, social network.
I'll make sure all your links are in the show description.
Yeah, thank you.
All right, that's the end of the show, and I hope you found it as much of a ride, pardon the pun, as I did. I did enjoy that conversation with Mu Ming. Literally, I say every time I enjoyed the conversation, but it's true. That's why I do the show, because I enjoy the conversations. Also the fame and adoration and the millions of yuan that pour into my bank account every month. That's pretty good too. If you'd like to help more millions of yuan pour into that bank account every month, then you can go over to patreon.com/TrChFic, TrChFic, in exchange for 0.00001 million yuan per month. You get access to every single bonus episode I've done, and there's a trickle of them coming out every 2 weeks or so. I haven't recorded any for a while, but I have a great big queue, so they still should be coming out regularly. At some point soon, I'm going to have to sit down and queue up some more. But yeah, there's lots of bonus stuff there. Usually it's about half an hour, sometimes less, sometimes more, of me just talking solo about something I've just read or just finished reading, preliminary thoughts, post-read thoughts, and also all the bonus answers to the bonus questions from these main episodes. That's all up there. lots of other ways you can support the show. A great thing you could do is give feedback, do it via the social media, links at the bottom of the episode description. There's a Discord link as well if you'd like a more open conversation with other listeners. That's all very good stuff to check out. Of course, the best thing I'm going to say that you can do for the show is tell people IRL. Tell people out there in the real world to listen to this show if you think they'd like it. So tell your friends, tell your family, tell your ticket conductor, and tell that strange guy next to you on the train. You know, he's maybe breathing a little bit too heavily, but maybe my soft, soothing vocal tones will calm him down and at least distract him as you try to enjoy your Gaultier high-speed rail train journey. So until you get to your destination, 再见。